Well, happy Easter and welcome to Parkview Community Church's online Easter experience. We're so glad that you've taken the time today to celebrate this incredible day with us. And we've got great things to come in the service ahead. But we're excited. We're excited for spring. We're excited for the new thing that God is doing here. We're excited for everything that Easter represents, new life and really our life in Christ. It's a special day for us as families as well. I know we've got some fun traditions. How about you, Andy? What are you doing today with your family?
Well, we don't have any traditions yet as a family. Ben's only 4 months old, so we got him all this Easter candy that we'll just have to eat, I guess, in preparation. No, my nieces and my nephew, they love the Easter egg hunt so much so that we just do it every time we're together now. It doesn't have to be Easter. We hide them in the snow or whatever, and they love it. Sometimes we can't find where we hid them. It's always the balance between too hard, and that produces tears.
Right.
Too easy, they find them and they're bored.
It's so too fast, tough. Right.
You really can't win either way. Yeah. But what about you guys?
We still do Easter baskets.
Nice.
The candy's still pretty important, so
yes,
you gotta do the Easter baskets.
Gotta have the Reese's peanut butter eggs.
Yep, and the Starburst jelly beans.
Yeah. My dad also a jelly bean guy year-round. I don't know where that comes from. But anyways, so Easter year-round at the Klinke
Easter
household
year-round.
Altogether.
I like it.
But we are so glad that you're with us. And if you're a guest with us, maybe you're just looking for a service for Easter. And because of COVID, you're just looking online and trying to find different places. And maybe you stumbled across our online service. Maybe someone invited you to check us out. We're just so glad that you are with us today. And we hope that you'll be encouraged by our service. We hope that you will really feel the hope that comes from the resurrection. And we really would love to get to know you as well, because that's really what being a church is about. It's about Jesus, and it's about helping and loving each other in our community and being in relationship with each other. That's what makes us unique than other organizations that are doing great things. We really do our best to do life together, and so we would like to start a relationship with you and see if there's any way that we can serve you and get to know you. So there's a little QR code on the screen, and if you just scan that and fill out some information, we're going to reach out to you and just introduce ourselves and see if there's any way that we can serve you or your family in this season.
Yeah, people are important to us because people are important to God. And we really believe here at Parkview that every story matters to God. And we want to see every story redeemed by the love of Jesus. And so what we're looking to do as a church, as a group of people, group of believers, is to love Jesus in a way that inspires other people to love Jesus. And our hope that in this next hour is that you would encounter Jesus, that you would be filled with the hope of his resurrection and new life. So let's join our worship team now as we continue in worship.
Well, come on, let's worship together. Easter Sunday, let's go. I was buried beneath my shame. Could carry that kind of weight. It was my doom till I met you.
Come on.
I was breathing, but not alive. All my failures, I tried. You could love. Let's sing this together with all we got. Let's go. I need a rescue. My sin was heavy. But chains break at the weight of your glory. I need a shelter. I was an orphan. Then you called me a citizen of heaven. When I was broken, you were my healing. Now your love is the air that I'm breathing. I have a future, my eyes are open. Cause when you call my name,
you. darkness we were waiting, without hope and without light, till from heaven you came running. There was mercy in your eyes to fulfill the law and prophet. To a virgin came the word, from a throne of endless glory to a cradle in the dirt. Praise the Father, praise the Son, praise the Spirit, three in one. God of glory, majesty, praise forever to the King of Kings. You saw to the other side, knowing this was our salvation. Jesus, for our sake you died. Thank you, Lord. Praise.
Happy Easter, Parkview. For thousands of years, followers of Jesus have united in one voice to declare Jesus is risen. We don't have a lot of traditions at Parkview, but just like we light candles on Christmas Eve to declare that the light of Jesus has entered the darkness of the world, on Easter, we declare the resurrected power of Jesus that has cut through the darkness of Saturday to bring light to the world on Sunday. So I'm going to say, rather emphatically, He is risen, and my hope is, wherever you are today, that you'll stop what you are doing and yell back at the screen in front of you, He is risen indeed. All right, are you ready? Okay. He is risen. He is risen indeed. Well done. Was that weird? Was it a little awkward for you? I'm sorry about that. But I'm so glad we did it together. So if you believe that this morning, here's what I want you to do. I want you just to type risen into the chat so that everybody who's with us this morning can see that he is risen, risen indeed. Well, welcome to Easter at Parkview. My name is Dave Davis, and I'm one of the lead pastors here at Parkview. And as others have said, we are so glad to have you with us this morning, this afternoon, or whenever you're watching this. If you're new to Parkview, welcome. I hope that you find a sense of community and acceptance here. We want you to know that your story matters to God, and it matters to us. Our entire mission is to love people, all people, well enough that they themselves will find their way to Jesus' love for them. I'm so excited about this message because I believe God has an important word for you today. All week, I've been walking around with this idea of life and resurrection, and I've been praying for you. I've been praying specifically for you that today would be the day you receive the breakthrough miracle power of resurrection. So if you have your Bible, or maybe you got your Bible app on your phone, open it to the Old Testament book of Ezekiel. Open it to chapter 37. Over these past few weeks, we have been in a teaching series called Memorable, where Ray and Andy have worked through some short but easy to memorize verses. The idea being that in today's technologically driven world, our need to memorize has been greatly diminished. Every bit of information we need is easily accessible. However, Scripture, the very word of God, when committed to memory, has the power to change our perspective, our view of the world around us. So today I've got another verse for you to think about, to memorize. Actually, it's just part of a verse, but according to Andy, it's okay. A partial verse counts as a whole verse. So that still counts. So Ezekiel 37, verse 14 says this, "I will put my spirit in you and you will live." Simple. 11 words, really easy to memorize. But listen, contained in those 11 words is the breakthrough miracle power of God's love for his people. Let me explain this verse. Verse 14 comes at the end of a really unusual narrative. Now, chapter 37 starts out with God communicating with a guy named Ezekiel. Ezekiel was an Old Testament prophet. Prophets were God's spokespeople, someone designated by God to repeat his word back to his people. Many of the flyover books in the Bible, those books that we tend to skip over between Psalm and Matthew, are books describing the very work of these prophets. Ezekiel was one of the latter prophets. Latter prophets are called that because they left behind written or literary works attributed to them by name. So Ezekiel has a book contained within the Old Testament with his name on it. Ezekiel's job, primary job, was to listen to God and repeat his words back to the people. They weren't philosophers meant to try and interpret or contextualize God's message. They were teachers bent on bringing God's message exactly as God spoke it, often with a message of warning or a call for change. This position of being a prophet carried a sense of authority, but often not popularity. You see, the words spoken by the prophets were, like the parables in the New Testament, intended to push against the status quo in order to bring about a better way, a different way. I mean, think about it. If every time you showed up at a block party or the lunchroom or even church, and everyone knew you were about to bring them a message from God that usually had words like repent, the end is near, or stop messing up, how popular would you be? Listen to what the prophet Jeremiah says in chapter 16 of his book. Then the word of the Lord came to me, which is how prophets start. You must not marry and have sons or daughters in this place. Right? The people were in this place and there were these people and he said, don't marry with these people. Not too bad, but hold on. Because he goes on to describe why they should not do that. He's prophesying what would happen to these kids and their parents and their grandparents. So listen, they will die of deadly diseases. They will not be mourned or buried, but will like dung lying on the ground. They will perish by the sword and by famine, and their dead bodies will become food for the birds of the wild and the wild animals. Nice, right? Jeremiah, likely not invited to a ton of parties with messages like that. So again, not an easy job being a prophet. But in chapter 37, Ezekiel gets to deliver a very different kind of message. A message still from God, but not necessarily a message of warning, one of hope. Let me set some context. Ezekiel is wrapping up a teaching to the nation of Israel. The people of God are in exile. They're homeless and they're captive to another group of people. Their home has been destroyed. They are alone and they believe God has abandoned them. And Ezekiel has been pushing against their open rebellion. They're grumbling against God and reminding them that God loves them, but they're hopeless and wandering in the desert, feeling very sorry for themselves. They are really living this life that is good as dead. It's a good as dead sort of life. In verse 1, Ezekiel is led out by the Spirit. This is a vision that Ezekiel has, and he's led out by the Spirit of God into the middle of a valley filled with human skeletons. The passage says that the valley is filled with bones, but the text adds that they were dry bones. They were very dead bones. And as they were walking across the valley floor, God asks Ezekiel, "Do you think these bones can live again?" What a question. I imagine Ezekiel thinking to himself, "Oh man, this is not good. I see where this is headed. This is not my first rodeo. When this is over, he's going to send me back to my people so that I can tell them that we are all about to die." Ezekiel could not see the future miracle right in front of him, right on the horizon, because his present reality was impacting his future possibilities. As they continue to walk, God asks him, "Again, do you think these bones can live again?" And Ezekiel responds in a very normal way. "I mean, I don't know, God. Only you know the answer to that question." So Ezekiel, in what I like to imagine this bit of fear-induced sarcasm, says, "Sovereign Lord, you alone know." Ezekiel puts the ball right back into God's court with a, "Why are you asking me? You're the only one that knows the answer to that question." And maybe with a little bit of an eye roll. So God tells Ezekiel to talk to the bones, prophesy to the bones. Ezekiel, he's been here before. He has the muscle memory to know what to do here. God has told him to speak before many times, but typically the audience is living. So this is very different. God is telling him to speak to an audience of disconnected, lifeless, dry bones. I imagine there's a bit of a disconnect between what he has seen before, experienced before, maybe even what he's seen in front of him, and what he believes are possible from God. So let's pick it up in verse 4. "Then God said to me, 'Prophesy to these bones and say to them, dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. This is what the sovereign Lord says to these bones. I will make breath enter you and you will come to life. I will attach tendons to you and make flesh come upon you and cover you with skin. I will put breath in you and you will come to life. Then you will know that I am the Lord.'" Ezekiel, he's saying to Ezekiel, "Just say these words and see what I can do." There's no magic here. There's no waving of the hands. There's no wand involved. He just started repeating the words God gave him. Christopher Wright, in his commentary on Ezekiel, puts it so beautifully. He says this, "Just as the living power of the word of the living God invading the valley of the shadow of death." Ezekiel communicates sort of even the averageness of these words when he says in the first part of verse 7, "So I prophesied as I was commanded. I just did what God told me to do." It's as if he was saying, "Yeah, so now what, God?" But in the second half of verse 7, something begins to happen. "There was a noise, a rattling sound, and the bones came together, bone to bone. And I looked, and tendons and flesh appeared on them, and skin covered them." I mean, put yourself in Ezekiel's shoes for a moment. Imagine the scene. Hear the rattle. Picture the dry bones beginning to shake and to move. The bones are coming together, the ligaments, the muscles, the hearts, the lungs all move across the desert floor. The dry, very dead, been dead for a long time, bones are rattling back together. Loose bones reassembling into fully formed bodies right in front of Ezekiel's eyes. And then, just as quickly as this miracle began, it's over. Everything stopped. If this were a movie, this is where the long pause would occur. Big dramatic music would swell, and the camera would slowly swing across the valley floor, revealing thousands of bodies spread out where dry bones once existed. And as the camera closes in on Ezekiel, you'd hear Morgan Freeman say, "But there was no life in them. But there was no life in them." The moment just stops. This truly miraculous moment just stops dead. In and of itself, this is an unprecedented expression of God's power. The bringing back of these dry bones is a miracle of God, but the circumstances really haven't changed that much. It's not finished. Certainly, the situation hasn't changed for Ezekiel. More importantly, nothing has changed for the lifeless bodies lying on the valley floor, because they're still very much not alive. As we read this, we know there is no way God brings Ezekiel to this dramatic moment just to leave it here. You and I can sense that there is more to this story, but Ezekiel didn't know what was coming next. So the silence that they experience in this pause in the verse, it comes to an end. And when God says to Ezekiel, "Talk to the wind." In fact, the text says, "Prophesy to the breath." It's like God leans into Ezekiel, maybe close enough to whisper the words directly into his ear, "Tell the wind to come." And with that, the winds from the north, from the south, from the east, from the west, began to swirl through the valley and into the nostrils of these fully formed but very dead bodies. It's a familiar wind, the wind that comes when the Spirit of God is getting to do something big. Say to it, "Come, breath, from the four winds and breathe into these slain, that they may live." The rattle of the bones turns to a gasp as the empty lungs fill with the breath of God, filled with the miraculous, life-giving, heart-beating, God-given air. They breathed in the resurrection. The Hebrew word here, used here to describe this wind, the Spirit of God, is ruach. It's a Hebrew word, and it's seen throughout Scripture. This ruach is not an insignificant part of the story. In fact, this word is used 10 times in these 14 verses. Contained in this single word is the human, the natural, and the divine. It is the literal breath. It is the literal wind, and it is the literal Spirit of God, all in the same time. All three coming together, bringing with it the resurrection power of God, life out of utter darkness. The text says, "I prophesied as he commanded me, and breath entered them. They came to life, and they stood up on their feet, a vast army." Moments earlier, they were dead, lifeless, dry bones, but the ruach entered them, and they came to life. Now, standing on their feet with the ruach in their lungs, pumping blood through their heart, they're restored, resurrected, fully living. This word, ruach, is a familiar one. It's present all through Scripture. In fact, it appears in the second verse of Genesis chapter 1. Listen, "Now the earth was formless and empty. Darkness was over the surface of the deep, and the ruach, the Spirit of God, was hovering over the waters." But it's also at the very end of the Bible, the very same Hebrew word reflected in the very last chapter of the Bible. Revelation 22, verse 17 says this, "The ruach, the Spirit, and the bride say, 'Come.' And let everyone who hears say, 'Come.'" And let everyone who is thirsty come. Let anyone who wishes to take the water of life as a gift come. Whenever this wind blows, it brings with it resurrection, life, but it also brings an invitation to come out of the tomb. The stone has been removed, come out of the tomb. And then, like at the end of any great dramatic film, the entire scene changes. No longer are God and Ezekiel standing in a valley surrounded by dry bones. Now they're in a familiar territory, and in front of them, the entire tribe of Israel, breathing, but dead on the inside. They are hopeless, alone, and experiencing the windless dark night of the soul. God begins to explain to Ezekiel what he just saw. He says, these bones are the people of Israel. They say, oh, our bones are dried up and our hope is gone. We are cut off. The bones you saw, Ezekiel, represent my people who are as good as dead. They are not living. But that isn't God's plan for his people. He is the God of resurrection power. And in this moment, God is saying to Ezekiel, as he's saying to you and to me, I see you. I know you feel defeated. Your world has changed. I hear your despair and your pain. I know you have felt isolated and cut off, but I have a message for you. This is what the text says. My people, I am going to open your graves and bring you up out from them. I will bring you back to the land of Israel. Then you, my people, will know that I am the Lord, when I open the graves and bring you up from them. I will put my spirit in you and you will live. I will put my ruach in you and you will live. This has always been, it always is, and will always be God's desire for his people. So I wonder this morning, this afternoon, do you feel cut off? Do you feel stuck, alone, separated? Do you sense there is more to this life than your present realities allow you to see? Do you long for a life that is filled with hope? Is your understanding of God shaped more by his absence than his presence? I have. I've had my own Valley of the Dry Bones experiences. But what if I told you that the Ruach of God is swirling right now? I mean, right now. Now. You see, the thing about resurrection stories that makes them so captivating is no one ever assumes that dead bones will come back to life. No one assumes that someone's going to get up out of a tomb and walk away. Even during Jesus' resurrection story, his closest friends had given up hope and had literally begun to move on with their lives. But resurrections are not historical events. They are ever-present moments filled with future possibilities. They are a hopeful expectation of a future living. From the beginning, God's plan has always been to bring us out of our good-as-dead existence and to bring us to life. The entire arc of human history pushes against life, but the God of the universe, filled with overwhelming love for you, wants to break through the darkness and bring you the resurrection power, a power made possible by Jesus' own resurrection. Listen, he's no longer in the grave, and today, right now, he's calling you out from yours. All week, I've sensed God saying, just say the word. I've sensed God saying, just say the word, breathe my ruach into your dry bones. An expectation for many of you to receive your resurrection today, that you would say yes to a future living. I've been praying for you. Today can be your day, your resurrection day. The thing is, resurrection does require something. It requires death. It requires a surrendering. We must experience the releasing before we can experience the receiving. The miracle breakthrough power of Ruach is present in the Valley of the Dry Bones. And Ruach was present when Lazarus shook off his burial wrapping. It's present with the woman at the well. It's present on the cross. It's present at the empty tomb in the garden. The same Ruach present in all of those stories is present today for you. He's still working. The Apostle Paul reminds us of this truth when he wrote Romans 8:11. And if the Spirit of Him who has raised Jesus from the dead is living in you, He who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies because of His Spirit who lives in you. It's Ruach that lives in you. The God of the universe is saying to you today, let me fill your life with my resurrection power. The God of the universe longs to bring life into your dry bones, into your fear, into your anxiety, your addiction, your uncertain health, your marriage, your dreams. God has so much more for your life. You can expect confidently a resurrection. So here's what I want you to do. I want you to take your hands, open them like this, palms up, a posture of surrender. And I want you to pray these words. God, I'm surrendering. I'm letting go of what I thought my life was supposed to be. I'm letting go of all the ways I have tried to control your plans for me. Like the text says, for I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope in the future. I'm sorry that I have tried to control those. God's plans to do immeasurably more than we could ever ask or imagine according to the power that is in work within in us. I want to let go of my control over those things. The same power that raised Jesus from the dead, the power to restore, the power to heal, the power to redeem, to heal and to restore. I'm so grateful for those things. And we thank you, God, for the resurrection power you are pouring out in us even now. There is more to this life than feeling disconnected, hopeless, and afraid. God didn't put you here to wander around directionless. Your end game is not a pile of dry bones. But what is standing in the way of your resurrection? What is keeping you in the grave? What do you need to surrender today? Is it your pride? Is it your fear, your control? Is it an unhealthy relationship? Is it your wounded understanding of God? Is it your past? Is it your future? Here's what I know. When the wind of God is blowing, it always comes with an invitation. An invitation to surrender and to receive. To surrender all that is holding you back and receive the breakthrough miracle power of God, the resurrection power of God. The invitation is to release and to receive. And the first step is the release. This is that posture, this open-handed posture. Release. Lord, I release the way I thought it should be. I release my sin. I release my anger. I release my depression. I release my pride, my self-reliance, my toxic view of the world, and my toxic view of you. You are the resurrection, and I give it all to you. The resurrection is right now for you. He still lives. He still moves. He still moves the stones blocking your life. He still brings dry bones back to life. He still forgives sin, and He receives all that you can give. So now, in the same posture, now that you have released, it's time for you to receive. To receive His forgiveness, receive His healing, to receive His mercy, and to receive His grace. Right now, I need, you need, the invisible God to become real. To become real in your life, in my life, right now. So I want you to pray. I want you to pray out loud these words. If today is your resurrection day, I want you to pray with me. Heavenly Father, today is my day of resurrection. I am a sinner in need of a Savior, and I give you my life. I believe Jesus died for my sin, rose from the grave to give me a new life. I receive this new life. I am a new creation, and I am a child of God. In Jesus' name, amen. Listen, if you prayed that prayer today, today is your day. And so I want you to remember it. I want you to tell people about it. So in the chat, I just want you to say, I receive it. I receive it. If today is your day, your resurrection Sunday, then I want you just to declare it. I receive it. As we continue on with our service, we're going to sing a song about the resurrection power. And as we sing that song, I want you to soak in all that God has for you today. The release of everything that has held you back and the receiving of the gift of resurrection power today for you at work in your life. I hope you have a great, great rest of the day. Enjoy. Enjoy this next moment between you and God.
Stacked against me, I'm surrounded on all sides, but I've heard you can part the waters, so in your name come and turn the tides. Stand chance I'm getting through, but I've heard they can melt before you, so in your name I'm asking it to move, yeah. So let that breakthrough miracle power.
I know.
The cross stands before me, and it's finished, it is done. Yeah, I heard you told death it was over, so in your name I'll claim this fight is won.
Well, our hope for you today as you watch this service is that you experience the hope that comes from the resurrection of Jesus. We looked at this ancient story of a pile of bones that, because of the power of God, new life was breathed into it. Something that was dead became alive. It's a miracle. It's something that only God can do. And maybe today, as you were watching, that's how you felt. You felt like a pile of bones. You felt dead inside. And you realized, maybe for the first time, maybe for the first time in a long time, that it's the power of God, that it's Jesus that can make you alive. Maybe you made a significant decision today around that. We would love to know. We would love to celebrate with you. We would also would love to help you in any way. And so if that's you, you made a decision that you're going to pursue life today in Jesus. Again, for the first time, or again, you can just email alive@parkview.cc. You can write a little bit, you can write your whole story, whatever is helpful for you, but we just want to get to know you, we want to celebrate with you, and we want to see if there's any way that we can serve you today. We also want to invite you back next week. We're here every Sunday. We have a service every Sunday. And next week we start a series in the book of Joshua, the Old Testament book of Joshua. And this, the stories that we're going to tell over the next few weeks, it's about the people of God that are on mission. And they are unstoppable. And they're unstoppable not because they're so incredible or such a powerful nation. They're unstoppable because they serve an unstoppable God. And so the stories that are recorded in this book are really incredible, and they point to an incredible God. So that's what we're going to look at over this next series. So I hope that you'll join us. And lastly, we want to remind you of the opportunity that is available really every day to be generous, to be a generous person. And as we think about being alive, I'll just tell you from experience, Brittany and I have never felt more alive than when we're being generous, when we're giving things away, when we realize that what we have has all been a gift from God, and we can use it, we can be a conduit, we can bless other people with it. We feel so alive. It's backwards. You would think maybe it wouldn't feel good. You would think that it means we have less, and so we have. That's not the case. Every time. I'm not even kidding. Every time we give generously, we feel alive, we feel full, and we feel like we're doing what God has called us to do. So we want to remind you that opportunity exists every day at Parkview. You can give online. If you come to an in-person service, there's a box in the lobby as well, if you're more comfortable doing that. And it's not just because we have to keep lights on here. It's because we understand that this is what God's called us to, and that as we're generous people, we become alive and we get to be used in a way that God wants us to be used. So we want to invite you back next week for our start of our new series in Joshua. And thank you again for joining us this Easter.